Name of group, excellent. Name of song, who are you? Let us pray as we stand. Heavenly Father, as you came to us in your Son, come and meet us in each and every day of our lives. Lead us into all that you would have us be in your name. For in Christ's name we pray, amen. Please sit down. If you're anything like me, you'll be humming that for the rest of the day. Last week, Arnold told us that the theme of this week was forgiveness, and indeed it is. In some versions of the biblical text, it's written there as a subtitle above today's gospel. But let's begin with good old Joseph and his brothers. Oh, those brothers who are so shrewd. They fabricate a little deceit, which is, at its heart is probably quite true, even if it never came from the lips of their father. They then embellish it just a little further, not saying, "But we are your servants and slaves, Joseph," but saying, "We are the servants and slaves of your father's God, Joseph." They know how to crank up the pressure. It is just like a schoolchild embellishing a lie as to who ate the last of the chocolate cake when it is all too obvious who did it. We continue those same lies as adults. We just get rather better at dissembling and cloaking the deceit. I think Joseph wept entirely understandably. And I think Joseph wept because he thought they'd come further than this. He thought in the time since they'd been back together, they had reunited as brothers and family. Forgiveness given and received, not only received, but wholeheartedly meant when it was given. How hard it can be to make forgiveness live. Usually, for me, it's the gospel that is the most powerful of the passages of Scripture which we read or hear or sing. Today, I think the gospel is the weakest of our passages, perhaps because this subject of forgiveness is not one for parallel or parable stories. It's about truth. It's about our truth. And it makes us ever so slightly sit up and listen in a different manner to think, am I doing it right? Am I doing it enough? Am I doing it too much? Have I been wronged more than I am the wrong'un, which is deliciously bad English, but quite fun to use? Let's find out, and let's see if it matters. Think back, though, to that middle reading from St. Paul to the Romans. He begins so gently, so broadly and openly, in order that he will then, by that pattern, draw us all in and very deliberately focus what he is saying on every single individual. Somewhere it will apply to all. And then we hear, "Who are you to pass judgment on the slaves of another? Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Why do you despise your brother or sister?" This casts us back a week or two to Jesus dismissing Peter with the words, "Get behind me, Satan, For you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. And who are we? During this week, during evening prayer, this passage was read from the book of the Acts of the Apostles. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for an entire year they associated with the church and taught a great many people. And it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. You see where I'm going with this. Peter was castigated for proclaiming Jesus as the Messiah, the Christ, but not grasping or allowing what that meant. The Christ is the Christ. This is not a staging post on a journey. This is not another prophet, a decent teacher, a nice guy. The Christ, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. We, therefore, live in the end times. Don't look at your watch, look at the age. We live in the light of Christ. We live in the life of Christ. He has come, he is, he will continue to be. It has happened. Redemption is made. All judgment has been passed. That old order of weighing the merits and debits of one another and seeing where we think we stand with relation to one another or in our expectations, it's gone. It's not just changed, it's not just altered slightly, it's not put on a shelf or in the back of the cupboard, it has gone. 7 times, 77 times, there is no such question. Who are we? We are we not, proclaiming ourselves as Christians? Our task, our freedom, is to live in this new covenant in Christ, offering free, open, self-denying, self-giving, endlessly generous, trusting love to all. All. Without exception, without weighing it up, without any change, all. Why bother to hold a grudge when you can flip it around and have for yourself the extraordinary delight of loving? Why choose to not forgive, to count the forgivenesses? It will be tiring for even an accountant who delights in the joy of numbers. Why count, why limit forgiveness when we can let it go and live to the eternal future? Or do we not believe that the Christ was, is, and will be big enough to redeem all things, even the things that hurt us? And saying, oh well, I think I've probably forgiven enough. I've probably done my share. It's time I got something back. I'm sure my needs, my pains, my woes, my mistakes are not as great as others. We don't know. Excuse the really bad English again, but we don't get to play that game. We're invited to grow up. We're invited to delight in ridiculous freedom, the freedom to forgive. And guess what? Take a look. There are no shackles on you. There is no dirt, no mark. You also are forgiven. And so am I. And what can I do about it? Well, I can get down in the dirt caused by me and others that's been washed off. Or I can stand tall and look again at Jesus Christ and see the Christ. And standing that tall, I can see a whole new, glorious, protected creation. Made in him, lived in by all who choose to follow him, for the benefit of all. Good news? It's only one decision away. Don't for a minute think I'm saying it's easy. But it's only one decision away. Who are you?